How did the war transform the region? And the reason why we think that this is a very interesting topic is because I think there's a lot of the issues that we're still dealing with today that have their roots in the aftermath of the Six-Day War. And Asha will go into more detail. So my first question really to Asha is I suppose if you could sort of take us briefly looking at the region just before the war, sort of what did that feel like? What are the main sort of trends that were already emerging? And then we'll discuss a bit about how it changed the Arab world. But if you could give us an overview briefly of that.
Well, I think a lot of people here and in the audience will remember the heady days of what was called Nasserism. When Gamal Abdel Nasser was the president of Egypt, and leading Egypt and the Arabs, generally speaking, towards what seemed to be this Arab nationalist ideal, which was based on three principles: Arab unity, Arab socialism, which meant government-controlled economies, and an alliance with the Soviet Union in the Cold War. And in the eyes of Abdel Nasser and in the eyes of most of the Arabs, this formula was the recipe for great Arab success. This was the formula that would transform the Arabs into not only a Middle Eastern power, but a world power. And of course, this was the recipe for the defeat of Israel. There were no supporters of Abdel Nasser greater than the Palestinians, because the Palestinians really and truly believed that Abdel Nasser, with Arab unity and Arab socialism and the alliance with the Soviet Union, would deliver Palestine. Now, it's true that before the war in 1967, the aura of Abdel Nasser was losing a bit of its flair. And Abdel Nasser already had courted some failures before 1967, the breakup of the Union with Syria, the civil war in Yemen. But still, Abdel Nasser was this great heroic figure. Comes the war in 1967. In 6 days, all of this is trashed. The Arabs in modern times, and I may think in any times, have never suffered a humiliating, disastrous defeat like the war of 1967. And that has created this watershed in Middle Eastern history, where the whole idea of Arab nationalism, this panacea for the ills of the Arabs, turned out to be an empty vessel. There was nothing in it. And the defeat in 1967 is an indication not only of the emptiness of Abdel Nasser's political philosophy, but more seriously and more deeply, the Arabs had failed to modernize successfully. Israel had. And Israel, by defeating the Arabs, became this monument to Arab inadequacy. And that has two consequences. One, the recognition by the key Arab states that they cannot defeat Israel. And the beginning of the idea of coming to terms with Israel emerges after 1967. So there is the beginnings of this recognition of the need to make peace with Israel. But at the same time, Israel as this monument to Arab defeat and inadequacy is detested, precisely because it is a reflection and a daily reminder to this very day of Arab weakness. So the peacemaking with Israel is a mixed bag. It's an acceptance of the reality, but no great love lost between the Israelis and the Arabs, and that remains true even with countries that we have made peace, like Egypt and Jordan.
What about other countries in the Middle East? I mean, we talked about Egypt. I mean, could you reflect a bit on the impact on Syria? Because that's obviously very important today. It's very current.
Syria was always more radical. The Syrians always believed in themselves as the beating heart of Arabism in Damascus. But the Syrians, as opposed to the Egyptians, are no match for Israel. And if the Egyptians decide, for whatever reason, to withdraw from the conflict with Israel, the Syrians cannot fight Israel on their own. Therefore, the decision that Egypt makes, whether it is war or peace, decides for the other Arabs, no matter what they may prefer, what their options are. Without Egypt, the Arabs have no war option. Egypt fought its last war with Israel in 1973, the Yom Kippur War, which essentially was a war not to destroy Israel, but to pave the way for a negotiation with Israel. We have not fought a war with any Arab state for 44 years. And the reason is that Egypt withdrew from the conflict. So if you look at the conflict between Israel and the Arabs, since 1973, that will be this October, will be 44 years. We haven't fought with an Arab state, not one. We have our troubles with the Palestinians. But the Palestinians are not a military match for Israel. So it's obviously a problem, and the conflict continues to fester. But we do not face, from the Arabs, the existential threat of the great war that we always feared before 1967.
Can I just ask you about the one element that we sometimes miss on this is some of the impact on Jordan. So, you know, Jordan loses, you know, its territory in the West Bank. It loses its, you know, pride and joy of being able to, you know, run Jerusalem and the Muslim holy places. But what about the other? I mean, how does what happened in the 67 war then sort of characterize the Israel-Jordan relationship?
Well, the key to Jordan's role in the conflict is Jordan's geopolitical centrality, sitting on the heart of the Palestinian question, as opposed to Syria. After 1948, Jordan controlled the West Bank. The Jordanians annexed the West Bank. And just as an aside, the term West Bank is a Jordanian invention. The Jordanians began to call the West Bank the West Bank from 1950 onwards, so as not to call it Palestine. After all, the West Bank was part of historical Palestine. For the Jordanians, their control of the West Bank was to de-Palestinize the Palestinians and to turn them into Jordanians, to Jordanize the Palestinians. And therefore, the term West Bank was actually an anti-Palestinian term. It was designed to eliminate the word Palestine from the atlas. After 1948, there is no Palestine. There is no territory on the map called Palestine. There is the State of Israel, there's the West Bank, which is part of Jordan, and there's the Gaza Strip. The loss of the West Bank in 1967 is dramatic and has very far-reaching consequences, not only for Jordan, but for Israel. The occupation of the West Bank arrested the process of Jordanization of the Palestinians. The Jordanians cannot Jordanize the Palestinians if they don't control the West Bank. Having lost the West Bank, the Jordanians lost their manipulative power to continue to control the destiny of the Palestinian people. And the Palestinians from 1967 onwards become a much more independent, autonomous player. Because the Jordanians no longer control the destiny of the Palestinians. And the Israelis are the occupation now against which the Palestinians reorganize and define themselves anew as Palestinians. So the war in 1967, by kicking the Jordanians out of the West Bank, ushered in the re-Palestinization of the Arab-Israeli conflict. From 1948 until 1967, Palestinians were not an independent player. They were hardly a player at all. After 1948, we signed a series of armistice agreements with the Arab states. We didn't even talk to the Palestinians. After 1967, that changes very seriously, and eventually Israel had no choice, not only to negotiate with the Palestinians, but to negotiate with the PLO, which Israel said it would never do.
Can I just ask, while we're talking about the West Bank, I think it's also important to just reflect a bit on the Gaza Strip. So, you know, Egypt was ruling the Gaza Strip for 19 years, from 1948 to 1967. But how was Egypt, you know, ruling over the Palestinians there? I mean, it's important just to reflect on that for a bit in the context of what you were saying.
The Egyptians had a totally different attitude. First of all, the Egyptians never annexed Gaza. Gaza was never annexed to Egypt. And the Palestinians in Gaza never became Egyptian citizens, which is totally different to the situation in the West Bank. The Jordanians annexed the West Bank, and all the West Bankers, every one of them, became a citizen of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. The Egyptians had no interest in Egyptianizing the Palestinians, which the Jordanians did want to do. And actually, the Egyptian policy in Gaza was contrary to the Jordanian policy and was often used in order to torpedo Jordanian policy. The Egyptians encouraged the establishment of the PLO and encouraged the rejuvenation of the Palestinian political entity through its control of Gaza. And Gaza was used by the Egyptians actually as a finger in Jordan's eye to promote Palestinianness and to continue to maintain the independent identity of Palestine, which the Jordanians did not want to do. And here the Jordanians and the Israelis had identical interests. There are only two countries in the Middle East who gave the Palestinians citizenship, Israel and Jordan. And neither one of them wanted the preservation of the independent Palestinian identity. And the war of 1967, obviously, the Israelis didn't realize that from day one, but actually reversed the process of Jordanization, which actually Israelis saw as a major interest of their own. And therefore, some of the results of the war of 1967 have in the long run been somewhat self-defeating for the Israelis. The lessons of 1967, we're still learning them. They're not over. And we live with the consequences of 1967, that change as we move along. And in very many respects, it has changed the Middle East, but it has also changed Israel and its place in the region and the place of the Palestinians. Essentially created a reality which the Israelis obviously were not in favor of, but one in which they had no choice but to eventually come to terms with independent Palestinianness, which obviously has changed the nature of the conflict, which is no longer the Arab-Israeli conflict. The Arab-Israeli conflict essentially is over. What we have is the Palestinian-Israeli conflict.
Do you think that, I mean, taking a step back, so after the war, what you talked about, where all of the Palestinians, essentially, apart from those who left sort of mandatory Palestine, are all together. So before, you've got some in Gaza under Egyptian rule, you've got some in Jordan under Jordanian rule, and you've got some in Israel. And then any attempt to try and do something together as a Palestinian people is completely, there's so many barriers, there's other people in the way. You've got Arab states who are saying, we're going to look after you, we'll do this, we'll do that, we will liberate Israel for you. And so then, after the Six-Day War, all of a sudden they're all together again. And there's huge opportunities there. And they realise that the Arab states are not going to help them. They've got to do it on their own. So does that make, and this is a question I don't know if you can answer, but does that then make an armed struggle with a Palestinian organisation inevitable because they can't achieve anything other way? What do you think about that?
Well, first of all, when you say put them all together, that is partly true, yeah. But only partly true. There is the Palestinian diaspora,
yeah,
outside Palestine, above and beyond the Palestinians in Gaza, in Israel, and in the West Bank. But what the Six-Day War did do, and the point you made is very valid. For the first time since 1948, the Palestinians in the West Bank, Gaza, and Israel communicate with each other freely. That was a major catalyst to the revival of Palestinian identity. And not only the revival of Palestinian identity in the West Bank and Gaza, the revival of Palestinian identity amongst Israel's Palestinian citizens. And the Palestinization of the Israeli Arabs, as we used to call them. A term, by the way, that the Arabs in Israel don't like at all. What is this Israeli Arabs? We're not your Arabs. We're Palestinians. And we're part and parcel of the Palestinian people. That is a kind of political attitude which didn't exist before 1967. And after 1967 has become far more accelerated and expressed with much greater fervor. And as a result, the tensions in Israel between the Jewish majority and the Palestinian minority are not declining, but in very many ways increasing. Israel doesn't only have to come to terms with the idea of Palestinianness in the West Bank and Gaza. But what does Israel do with Palestinianness in Israel? Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people, and it seeks to remain so. Israelis are, may differ and argue about Israel's borders. Should Israel keep the West Bank? Should it not? Was it a good idea to give up Gaza? Was it not? But very few Israeli Jews would think that Israel should cease to be the nation state of the Jewish people. All Israelis from left to right are united on that. But Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people, and it should remain so. But 20% of the people in Israel are not Jewish. So how do they relate to this nation state of the Jewish people, to its symbols? Do you really expect the Palestinians in Israel who play soccer for Israel to sing Hatikva, which is all about Jewish national aspirations? The flag is typically Jewish. The Palestinians in Israel can't possibly be expected to really identify with that. So what do we do about this? I mean, these are new questions that didn't exist before 1967.
Let's move on to something slightly different, which is something that I think a lot of people don't always acknowledge when they think about the Six-Day War, is the argument that the Six-Day War catapults political Islam and Islamic extremism much further than it would otherwise have been. And there's very interesting stuff in the writings of some of the thinkers behind the sort of Islamist movement, that when they're looking at what happens in the Six-Day War, they see it as a failure of secular Arab nationalism, that it turned its back on Islam or only used Islam very superficially, and that is why they, you know, there was such a disaster. They look on the Israelis flocking to the Kotel and going back to their biblical lands, and they say, you know, here is a people that's returning to its roots, that understood the role of religion, which is ironic because at that point it was a very secular society. And they say, well, look at them. They understand tradition, they understand the role of religion, and we left religion behind, so therefore we must go back to our roots. We must, you know, find a way of making fundamentalist Islam a way of running our political system. So I wonder if you could reflect on that a bit more, and whether that argument is a very strong argument, and, you know, does that take us in a straight line to ISIS today? I'm asking you a lot here, but...
Well, there is there definitely is a connection, but what I would not want to argue is that the Six-Day War created political Islam. And that the fact that there is political Islam, that's also Israel's fault. Well, it isn't. But what the Six-Day War exposed was the emptiness of Nasser's brand of Arab nationalism. The Six-Day War exposed the inherent weaknesses of Arab society. It didn't create them, but it exposed them. And the Islamists after the war in 1967 could now say with a great measure of conviction, we told you so. All this Arab nationalism is bunk. After all, what is Arab nationalism? Arab nationalism, at least in theory, is a secular idea. Arab nationalism is a novelty. It is taken from 19th century European nationalism, where people were defined by the language they speak. You speak German, then you're a German. You speak Italian, you're an Italian. You speak French, you're a Frenchman. This linkage in very many places in Europe between language, territory, and nationhood. And the Arabs took a leaf out of this European book of nationalism and began to argue that the speakers of the Arabic language are also a nation. What that means, however, is that for the first time in hundreds of years since the advent of Islam, people were no longer defined by their religious belief. In the Middle East, people were never defined by the language they spoke. People were never defined by the territory they inhabited. In the Middle East, in the Ottoman Empire, and in the Muslim empires that preceded the Ottoman Empire, people were defined by their religion. You were either Muslim or not. The notion that people should define themselves by the language they speak is basically secular, putting Christian speakers of the Arabic language and Muslim speakers of the Arabic language and potentially Jewish speakers of the Arabic language in the same national identity. For the Islamists, Arab nationalism is this aircraft carrier of secularism. And therefore, when the Six-Day War ended the way it did, by the way, the term Six-Day War is an Israeli term. The Arabs don't use it. The term itself is humiliating. The Arabs prefer to call it the 67 War or the June War. The Six-Day War is an Israeli term, which is also a reflection of Israeli euphoria, which turned into arrogance in the aftermath of the great victory, which shocked the Israelis. I mean, the Israelis did not expect things to work that way. I was a soldier in the Six-Day War. I was 19. So I was doing my regular service, and I was participated in the fighting on the West Bank. So if you have complaints about the occupation, it's my fault. But I remember when we heard the first rumors that the Egyptian Air Force had been destroyed, we didn't believe it. We thought, we said, this is Israeli propaganda. So we're trying to beef up our own. We ourselves did not believe what the achievements until we really found out that it was actually true. Now I've forgotten what I was going to say. Where did we start?
You were doing the aircraft carrier of secularism.
Of secularism. Yeah. And so the Islamists could now argue with a great measure of conviction. We told you so. Secularism is not the solution. Islam is the solution. And that is the slogan. The Islamists say in Arabic, Islam is the solution. Islam huwa al-hal. And they could now say so with a great measure of popular support. When Abdel Nasser was at his height, the Islamists were there, but nobody took them seriously. And Abdel Nasser hanged them anyway. But after 67, their message was far more understandable, far more acceptable, and secular nationalism was dealt a serious setback and has since never quite recovered. Look at Palestinian-ness. Palestinian-ness has evolved after 1967 and developed after 1967. But what is Hamas? Hamas is not against Palestinian-ness, but it's about the Islamization of Palestine. Whereas the secular Palestinian national movement was talking about the Palestinization of Islam. Hamas speaks about the Islamization of Palestine. Where will Palestinian-ness be in two generations from now? I have no idea. Collective identity is not given. It changes over time. And where Palestinian-ness will be in 15 or 20 years' time is difficult to say. But secular nationalism, whether Palestinian, Algerian, or Turkish, is on the back foot, in retreat.
So let's move on a bit to the international community. I mean, we could spend the whole day talking about Russia and America and their roles and what they did or didn't do. But I think talking a bit about, say, the aftermath of the war and what happened with the international community, Resolution 242, and then you first get this idea of, you know, Israel giving land back in return for peace and security, and that becomes a consensus point pretty much between everybody at the UN, between the Soviet Union, between America. So I think if we could explore that a bit, that would be very interesting.
Well, first of all, I think we should recognize that Resolution 242 from November 1967 is a very favorable resolution from Israel's point of view. It took Israel a long time to realize that, and I think many Israelis probably wouldn't even agree with that now. But what does Resolution 242 say? It doesn't require Israel to withdraw forthwith from the territories it has just occupied. It says that Israel should withdraw from territories occupied in exchange for peace and recognition. It's not unconditional. People say that the Israeli occupation is illegal. Well, I'm not a great fan of the Israeli occupation, I'll tell you right now, but it's not illegal. In fact, Resolution 242 does not require Israel to withdraw except for peace. And if peace is not in the offing, Israel doesn't have to withdraw. The international community, since 1967, and this has only increased as time has gone by, recognizes Israel within the 67 boundaries, that is Israel in 78% of historical Palestine, as the nation state of the Jewish people, more than it ever did before 1967. Some of you may recall or know, in the 1950s, the UK, together with the US, put huge pressure on Israel to give up parts of the Negev to Abdel Nasser. Israel's borders pre-67 weren't recognized by the international community. Whereas post-67, in the demand that Israel withdraw to the 67 boundaries, essentially Israel in the 67 boundaries is fully recognized, and that there is no challenge to Israel in the 67 boundaries, and there is no challenge to Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people either. if you read Kerry's speech that he made just after the UN resolution in December last year, a speech that many in Israel and in Jewish communities were very upset about, Kerry speaks about the solution for the refugee problem. And essentially what he says there is quite similar to what President Clinton said in 2000, was that there should be a solution to the refugee problem that does not affect Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people, i.e. the refugees must not return to Israel. Well, that's Israel's position. The international community, and here I come to the point of the 1967 issues and the 1948 issues, we have had two great wars, the 1948 war, the War of Independence, and the 1967 war. And each of these wars have created issues, political issues, that have to be resolved. And with the Palestinians, we have two packets of issues. We have the 1948 questions, and we have the 1967 questions. The 1948 questions are those that relate to Israel's existence, the refugees, and the status of the Palestinian minority in Israel. That is, these 1948 questions don't relate to the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza. They relate to Israel's existence as of 1948. And then there is the bag of 1967 issues, which is Jerusalem, settlements and borders, etc. On the 1967 issues, the international community is at one against the Israeli position. Israel is alone on the 1967 issues, that it doesn't want to withdraw to the 67 boundaries, believes in the unification of Jerusalem, etc. But on the 1948 questions, the international community is with Israel, not with the Palestinians. The international community has not bought into what the Palestinians call the right of return. And that only reinforces the point I was making before, that Israel of 1948 is fully accepted as a legitimate member of the family of nations. That, I may tell you, is a great achievement, that the international community doesn't question at all our possession of 78% of historical Palestine, leaving the Palestinians with 22%. That's what the West Bank and Gaza are, the 22% that remain. So in that respect, if you look at it from the point of view that I'm suggesting, we're a lot better off than we were before. And here I'll say something just to cause some further provocation. Why did we get the resolution in 1967? Which, by the way, Egypt and Jordan accepted. That is already the beginning of them withdrawing from the conflict. If they accept the idea that all states in the region should exist in secure and recognized boundaries, as the resolution suggests. The resolution of 1967 was favorable to Israel because the war of 1967 was seen by the international community as a war of self-defense. It was not understood as a war of aggression. Israel was under pressure, Israel was surrounded by the Arabs, there were threats to attack Israel and even destroy Israel. And the Israelis rose up and mobilized and fought back and won this phenomenal victory. Zionism as a project of historical self-defense of the Jewish people against their horrific fate enjoys very widespread international legitimacy. And along with this self-defense, Zionism as self-defense, comes the Israeli acceptance of the partition of Palestine. Two states. We have enjoyed the legitimacy of the international community because of our acceptance of two states. You can read the Balfour Declaration. You can read the partition of 1937 and the partition of 1947. Never has the international community recognized all of Palestine as belonging to the Jews. Not even in the Balfour Declaration. The Balfour Declaration speaks about a Jewish national home in Palestine. not the transformation of Palestine into a Jewish national. Post 67, we have taken a position somewhat less self-defensive. And there are those, the supporters of the settler movement, who essentially speak not of self-defense, but of religious revivalism and rejection of partition. That, I would argue, is seriously undermining Israel's international legitimacy. Because our legitimacy is founded from the very beginning on Zionism as self-defense and the acceptance of partition.
Is it worth us just thinking about how that settler movement then began? Because if we take a big jump there, we say, right, 67, and then we're talking about now, but how did it all start?
Well, the settler movement actually, the very beginnings of it were forced upon the Israeli government by people on the religious political right. First of all, it was the people from the Etzion bloc that fell in 1948, who immediately after the war demanded to go back.
Which is legitimate. It was a community beforehand.
Yeah, legitimate, and therefore the government agreed to it, yeah. But it wasn't initiated by the government. Then there was the establishment of the Jewish community in Hebron by Rabbi Levinger, who went there in Pesach 1968, asked the government to have the Seder in Hebron, and the government said, okay, you can have the Seder. And when the Seder was over, he refused to leave. So the settler initiative was in large parts, and in the last 20 years mostly, settlements established without decisions by the Israeli government. In fact, the settler movement has been a significant erosion of government authority. But then there were also the settlements established by the Labour Party, the idea of that Yigal Alon had of settlements in the Jordan Valley, the Alon Plan, and there were settlements that were established by the government with government blessing. But since the rise of the Likud to power, and then from Menachem Begin onwards, there has been both government-approved settlements, but also to a large extent, since from Oslo onwards, none established by government decision. The government is now talking about establishing a new settlement for the people who were kicked out of Amona. That will be the first government decision to establish a new settlement since 1991. So largely, the settlement enterprise has been thrust upon the Israeli public by a very effective settler movement. And one may say we should take our hats off to them for their political effectiveness. But this was essentially a very militant minority imposing its ideas and views on the great majority of the Israeli people.
Do you think it's something in the victory of 1967 that makes the settler movement more attractive, that propels it to this notion that is bound up with this sort of redemption, this salvation, and there's this argument that, you know, a post-67, what was the sort of utopian Zionism of the kibbutzim, sort of starts to wane, and the sort of utopian Zionism of sort of the settlers starts to grow, and then they become sort of the vanguard of what is exciting about Zionism.
Well, I think it's the occupation of the West Bank. Mm. I mean, the West Bank and the West Bank is biblical Israel, not the coastal plain where most of us live. Mm. Ramat Gan and Givatayim are not in the Bible. You can work hard to find it, you won't. And certainly Tel Aviv isn't either. The heart of biblical Israel is in the West Bank. the occupation of the West Bank and the unification of Jerusalem, the possession of the Kotel, the recapturing of the Jewish Quarter, which we lost in 1948. All of this was a huge encouragement for this, let's say, militant religious revivalism. Without the West Bank, it would not have been possible. And it's the capturing of the West Bank that made all of this possible, and that also encouraged the rabbis to go in this direction, that now became an opportunity. Before 67, we never even used to talk about it. I was in high school before 67. I do not remember one discussion in all of high school. I finished high school in 1966 on Jerusalem. Not one. That we have no access to the Kotel and the Jewish Quarter, etc. It wasn't ever spoken about. It was a non-issue. We accepted the reality for what it was. And just a historical anecdote to this, in the latter part of the war of 1948, we could have taken all of the West Bank. We could have taken all of Jerusalem. It was there to be taken. The Arabs were on their knees. We never did. We never took even the Kotel and the Jewish Quarter. It was doable. The fight for Jerusalem in 1948 was one of the hardest fought of all. But not because of Jerusalem's holiness. Because there were 100,000 Jews in Jerusalem. And Ben-Gurion and the leadership were absolutely convinced that if Jerusalem with its 100,000 Jews fell to the Arabs, we would not be able to face the music. It would be such a disaster that we would lose the war. The fight for Jerusalem, therefore, had nothing to do with the holy sites. And when the war was over, even though we could have taken the holy sites, we never did. And the Kotel and the Jewish Quarter were left in the hands of the Jordanians. Ben-Gurion, if you remember, the partition resolution of 1947, Jerusalem is not part of the Jewish state, it's not part of the Arab state either. Jerusalem is a separate entity to be governed by the United Nations. So Ben-Gurion, very wisely, when we could have taken it all, decided not to, because he said, if we take it all, the whole world will gang up against us and call for internationalization of the city as endorsed by the UN resolution. If we split it between ourselves and the Jordanians, the international community will live with it. Half with the Jews and half with the Arabs. And so we and the Jordanians actually surreptitiously had a common interest to leave things in Jerusalem exactly as they were, and we did. Just an indication of where Israel was in terms of secular Zionism and religious Zionism in 1948 versus the post-67 period.